2 years ago, Deadpool appeared and thrilled the mainstream movie-going public with its everything. Its fourth wall breaks, self-referential humour, ironic pop rock soundtrack, and bloody violence, it had many things going for it, not least a pitch-perfect performance from Ryan Reynolds. Furthermore, it was extremely satisfying to see Fox Marvel taking some cheap shots at itself and superhero films in general. All in all, it was pretty great. But released half a decade earlier, another film can lay claim to being the first postmodern superhero film. Matthew Vaughn's Kickass. Kickass is a 2010 film about an ordinary teenager named Dave, who one day decides to become a superhero. But he has no powers, and he's a teenager. A teenager who thinks calling his new persona Kickass is a good idea. There's a storywriting trope called the hyper-competent man, a character that is skilled in all that he encounters. Dave slash Kickass is not a competent man. And this skill gap is widened after the introduction of vigilante Team Supreme, Hit Girl and Big Daddy. Will Dave succeed in his new vocation, or will he die trying? If you haven't already, go watch it. Minor spoilers from now on. Where Deadpool has the ability to reference Wolverine and the other X-Men to its heart's content, Kickass does not have the rights to these characters. Kickass does not have a mythology of its own, especially not one that spans decades. As such, the film references other superheroes not as in-film reality, but as pop cultural artifacts, the way the audience would. Characters in Kickass read Scott Pilgrim, Ditko-era Spider-Man, and spout lines from Jack Nicholson's Joker.
Where do they get a load of me?
More than simply consuming this media, it is a way for these characters to understand and live their daily lives. For example, when Dave looks at his post-accident x-ray, he says,
I look like freaking Wolverine.
He's using character reference as a shorthand simile for his newly reinforced metal adapted skeleton. To further this, the x-ray itself is a reference to the first X-Men film. This isn't the only time Vaughn recalls classic shots from superhero films. The training montage is pretty much a shot-for-shot copy of the one from Sam Raimi's Spider-Man. It's not just visually that Vaughn alludes to these films. The central musical themes for both Kick-Ass and Red Mist are pastiches of John Williams' work on Superman and Danny Elfman's on Batman. This is without taking into account the massive Batman figure that is Nicolas Cage's Big Daddy, almost lawsuit provoking with his Adam West voice disguise.
Good move, ass, kick.
As Vaughn says on the commentary track,
it's called parody, Marvel, parody.
The only way that the director can allude to these characters and assets legally is for the sake of comedy. But instead of being a skin-deep comparison, like the scary movies of this world, the genre and its history runs deep within Kick-Ass's veins.
Or all my coke was stolen by Superman.
Batman.
I never said Batman!
Enough!
While Deadpool has a sense of humor way darker than anything in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, Kick-Ass's comic sensibility is jet black. Both films' titular characters have a near-death origin story, but Kick-Ass makes his into a frankly hilarious joke. Being an independent production, Kick-Ass is able to push the boundaries of taste and brutality further than Deadpool dared. When Vaughn was first trying to make the film, major studios weren't interested, or if they were, they wanted things changed. Nicolas Cage can't shoot a 12-year-old in the chest. Hit Girl can't say the word cunt. This character can't get graphically beaten to a pulp and burnt alive.
Everything that I felt would be fresh and different scared them. And understandably, you know, the idea of an 11-year-old assassin with a filthy mouth, you know, they were like, no way would we ever let that happen.
Vaughn's punk rock mentality took this opposition as fuel, giving the final film its hunger and hard edge. Pre-Deadpool, most mainstream superhero films were a bit squeamish about showing blood, gore or excessive senseless killings. There were exceptions, but for the most part, it was not done. In a way, Deadpool's OTT splatter pretty much paved the way for the exquisite R-rated butcherings in Logan. And Deadpool's violence is great. Slow-mo headshots, unnecessary amputations, and the bit with the Zamboni. It's bloody good fun. But Kickass has all of that, plus a bit where some guy explodes in a giant microwave. But the best occurrences of movie violence, again like in Logan, are used as a way to say something about the nature of violence. Kickass has two thesis statements. Number one, that people are self-interested and unwilling to help those in danger. According to the film, this is why there are no superheroes in real life. And number two, that violence is a cycle that you cannot soon escape. As cool as Hit Girl looks, offing a hallway of bodyguards, Kickass makes it very clear that the death-filled way she lives her life is extremely detrimental to herself and those around her. If you live by the butterfly knife, you may die by the butterfly knife. Very few films that are this out-and-out comical have this much to say about people, superheroes, and the people that adore superheroes. It makes perfect sense that after this, Matthew Vaughn went on to direct X-Men First Class. Such is his affection for the genre. Kick-Ass is that rarest of things, a competently made parody. A love letter to and piss take of all things super, while still being bloody violent and incredibly crafted to boot. It truly kicks butt.
Now, if you look at this, this is ridiculous, isn't it? You've got two guys dressed in as superheroes having a conversation, and the fact that people seem to like it is a miracle.
Thanks for watching. If you like that, please remember to like, comment, and subscribe. Also, be sure to check out my various social media portals. Links in the description. See you in 3 weeks.